Welcome to the roller coaster ride known as the teenage years, where life is a whirlwind of raging hormones and the thrill of romantic sexual relationships. You might be thinking, why bother with safe sex? What's the worst that could happen? It's not like you would contract a sexually transmitted disease anyway. Wrong. Contrary to popular belief, the risk of contracting a sexually transmitted disease is very real during this phase of life, and there's another plot twist that you'll have to keep watching to find out. Before we delve deeper into the topic of sexually transmitted diseases and infections, let's start with some quick definitions. First, what are sexually transmitted diseases or infections? Sexually transmitted infections, or STIs, are infections caused by organisms that can lead to diseases in their host and are typically transmitted through sexual contact. Sexually transmitted diseases, or STDs, arise due to the development of infections leading to recognizable disease states. More specifically, sexually transmitted diseases are groups of communicable diseases, which are illnesses caused by viruses or bacteria that may have been spread through contaminated surfaces, bodily fluids, blood products, insect bites, or simply through the air. Sexually transmitted infections can be bacterial, viral, or parasitic. Bacterial examples include chlamydia, gonorrhea, and syphilis. Viral examples are HIV or AIDS, herpes simplex virus, HSV, human papillomavirus, HPV, and hepatitis B virus. Unfortunately, these viral sexually transmitted infections are incurable. A parasitic example is Trichomonas vaginalis. Of these infections, four are curable: syphilis, gonorrhea, chlamydia, and Trichomonas vaginalis. There are many ways that sexually transmitted diseases and infections can be spread. Remember that plot twist in the beginning? Well, having unprotected sex isn't the only way of contracting sexually transmitted diseases. Having protected sex doesn't guarantee that you'll be safe from contracting STDs either. Common forms of spread can often include fecal-oral, the sharing of food, sexual intercourse, whether it be vaginal, anal, or oral, insect bites, contact with contaminated objects, droplets, or skin contact. Sexually transmitted diseases can also be transmitted to babies when mothers are breastfeeding. Additionally, newborns of mothers who have contracted STDs may be at risk for developing various infections. In other words, the exchange of bodily fluids does not always need to occur for the transmission of sexual infections and diseases, meaning it is extremely important to be aware of who you come in contact with. Now for some quick numbers. In 2017, it was found that some of the greatest prevalence rates of sexually transmitted diseases came from chlamydia and gonorrhea. Females aged 15 to 24 were found to have over 715,000 cases in 2013 to over 770,000 cases in 2017. Males aged 15 to 24 were found to have over 230,000 cases in 2013 to over 295,000 cases in 2017. As for gonorrhea, females aged 15 to 24 were found to have over 100,000 cases in 2013 to 130,000 cases in 2017. For males aged 15 to 24, cases went from over 70,000 in 2013 to over 100,000 cases in 2017. So, you might be wondering how sexually transmitted diseases and infections actually work. Well, there are several ways in which they function, depending on the type of infection. However, the various ways in which these infections interact with the mucosal layer of female genitalia can ultimately lead to an inflammatory response being triggered. The mucosal layer is an important physical and biological barrier that provides protection against invading microorganisms. Inflammatory responses occur due to the activation of the immune system. The inflammatory response is created at the mucosal barrier of the genital mucosa and occurs when signal-receiving proteins expressed on the cell surface or interior of the cell detect patterns of disease-causing organisms. Normally, inflammatory responses work as a protection mechanism, but in this case, once it has been triggered, this will result in damage to the epithelial barrier within the mucosa. The epithelial barrier is extremely important as it is comprised of multiple layers of epithelial cells that work to protect the vaginal area from organisms that bring about diseases to the host. Damage to the epithelial barrier results in the further development of consequences such as epithelium degradation, pelvic inflammatory disease, and complications with pregnancy and fertility. Additionally, when there is damage caused to the epithelial barrier, there is an increased risk of acquiring sexually transmitted diseases such as HIV due to the virus gaining greater access to specific HIV target cells known as CD4 plus T cells, which are the preferred cells HIV prefers to replicate in. CD4 plus T cells are lymphocytes, which are a type of white blood cells within the immune system that help to fight infection by stimulating other immune cells. Since HIV prefers replicating in CD4 plus T cells, this leads to a weakened immune system. The mucosa's response to these infections varies depending on the STI, but can present itself as ulcers in the genitals, anus, perianal or mouth, discharge in the vagina or urethra, or genital warts. As for the diagnosis of sexually transmitted diseases, physical exams can be performed, and the extraction of sores or fluids from the vagina, penis, or anus is examined under microscopes. With the extracted fluid, the doctors will want to see if any infectious bacteria or yeast are present. Pap smear tests are used to help diagnose human papillomavirus, HPV, which can cause genital warts and cervical cancer. Cell samples from the cervix can also be collected and microscopically examined for abnormalities. To detect the presence of diseases such as hepatitis A, B, and C, or HIV or AIDS, doctors can use blood tests. Now, you're probably wondering, how do you treat sexually transmitted infections and diseases? This all depends on what the sexually transmitted disease is. For bacterial infections like chlamydia, gonorrhea, syphilis, and parasitic infections like trichomoniasis, treatment involves single-dose regimens of antibiotics. Treating herpes and HIV is more difficult because they are not curable, but antivirals can be used to help regulate the course of the disease. However, treatment has come a long way. Fun fact, back in 1778, when soldiers in the army were diagnosed with a sexually transmitted disease, they received fines from $4 up to $10, and in 1814, when soldiers had to take time off due to contracting an STD, they would not get paid. In 1909, arsenic was used to help treat syphilis, and salvarsan was introduced in the 1920s. Soon after, in 1943, penicillin was introduced as a treatment method for syphilis and gonorrhea. Let's summarize what we just learned. In this video, we went over the background, prevalence rates, mechanisms, diagnosis, and treatment of sexually transmitted diseases and infections. Remember, your choice of sexual partners can significantly impact your risk of contracting an STD or STI, so exercise caution and prioritize your well-being. If you ever experience symptoms suggestive of a sexually transmitted infection, don't hesitate to seek prompt medical attention. Your health is paramount, and an early detection and treatment can make all the difference.